tip of your head down to your feet?
Well, I'd worked homicide for a couple of years, and I'd seen many shootings and dismemberments and some gory things. But to see a freshly severed head with the eyes and the guy's mouth open in an empty refrigerator, the word surreal is used many times, and you don't understand it, but it was. It was an irrational fear. There was Jeffrey Dahmer was arrested. He was handcuffed. He had two police officers in control of him, and I had a partner there, and I was armed with a gun, so I knew I wasn't in any danger. But it was just an overwhelming, almost irrational fear. Of course, I knew you can't walk away from something like that, so you have to get control of it. But the initial shock of seeing, of opening the refrigerator and finding the head with the guy's eyes and face looking at you, it was...
Why tell that story now? Because it's been years and years, you know, two decades since America was sort of living through the headlines about the Jeffrey Dahmer story. Why did you, as a filmmaker, want to tell that story now?
Well, I grew up in Milwaukee. My parents got divorced, and I was actually living between Milwaukee and Madison. And I remember that people talked about it in Madison very differently than they talked about it in Milwaukee.
How do you mean?
Milwaukee, they talked about it like it was a flood or a hurricane. It was a disaster that affected a lot of people. In Madison, people talked about it like it was a movie that was coming out, you know, next Friday night. They were sort of more excited about it. And so I was just really curious how the effects had lasted and unfolded over, you know, a long time. So I think for something that's this complicated and dense, to look back 20 years later, sort of see how Pat and Pam and Dr. Jensen, the other people we interviewed for the film, the medical examiner, next door neighbor, how does it sort of affect you over the long term? How does it, I think looking back, you have sort of some 2020, you get to look at things a second time and sort of see how it all unfolded, which
well,
I think.
Well, and it seems like those that were most devastated by this were the people that knew him. And we talk often about the difference between a mass murderer and a serial killer, and that sometimes with a serial killer, the signs you can't always see early on. Is that why they were so disturbed by what happened?
Well, I mean, imagine your next door neighbor killed and ate 17 people. I mean, that would be tough for anyone to have to deal with. So I think it's interesting. Pat often says, had I asked him to do this interview a year after, you know, it happened, he wouldn't have been able to talk about it.
How did it affect you? I mean, 20-some-odd years later, do you, if you couldn't talk about it a year out, but 20 years later, does it still affect you? I mean, how has it changed you?
Well, I wasn't really allowed to talk about it until I retired in 2001. We were under a gag order. At the time, I was a young detective. It was 20 years ago. So it was exciting. But the 6 weeks that I spent interviewing him, 8 to 10 hours a day, and we'd have breakfast and lunch together. It became so intense. I was highly aware that it was publicized, and I didn't want to make a mistake. So I put all my time and my efforts, and I guess my whole life really went into that interrogation at the time, because that's all I could really do.